Okay, welcome to part two of this AQA paper. We're on question 18. So here is a tunnel for a toy train. The diagram below shows the cross section of the tunnel. Okay? So, AD is a semicircular arc of radius 10. BC is a semicircular arc of radius 7. And we're told that the length of the tunnel, so draw that in, this length here, is 30. So that's going to help us out in a moment. Alright, work out the total area of all six phases of the tunnel. So let's just draw on all six phases. So this is one, and there's an identical one on the back. This is three, there's an inside one, four, and then the two bits underneath are faces as well, five and six. So the easiest two to work out, I think, are the two bits underneath, 5 and 6. Right? So they're 30 long, and this bit here is 3 centimeters. So, because they're both the same, we've got two lots of 3 times 30. And this is 180. So that's our 5 and 6. Right? Next, we could do perhaps 3. So let's look at 3. Right, it's essentially a rectangle, right, where this length is 30, and this is going to be, well, it's the circumference of this circle with radius 10. So remember, the circumference equals pi times the diameter, but that's of a full circle. We want the circumference of a semicircle. So in our case, C is going to be pi times 20, but we want C divided by 2, which equals 10 pi. So, the area of 3 then, write that down here, area of 3 is, so we've got a rectangle with 10 pi and 30, that's going to be 300 pi. Right, 4 is going to be similar, but it's just going to be a rectangle where the width is 7 pi instead. Because it's the inside of the tunnel, this is still going to be 30, but this is going to be 7 pi, because it's the inner circle of radius 7. Okay, so area of 4 is going to be 210 pi. Okay, great, so far, we have 510 pi plus 180. But what are we missing? Well, we've got 5 and 6, we've got 3 and 4, we just need 1 and 2. Now, to work out the area of this shaded bit here, what we need to do is we need to do the semicircle of radius 10, take away the semicircle of radius 8. And we do that by using our well-known area of a circle. Pi times 10 squared over 2, take away pi times 7 squared over 2. And if you work this out, you'll get 51 pi. Oops. Apologies for that. Right, so if you work that out, you'll get 51 pi 61 pi divided by 2. Right, and we've got two of those, so the area of, what did I call them up here, 1 and 2, is 2 times 51 pi over 2, which just equals 51 pi. So adding everything together, we are going to end up with 561 pi plus 180. And that is our final answer for that. Right, question 19. Type A batteries and type B batteries were tested. The cumulative frequency diagram shows information about type A. To estimate the interquartile range for type A. So we can see that the graph goes up to 80. To find the interquartile range then, we need the lower quartile, which in this case is going to be 20, and the upper quartile, which is going to be 60. So, for those two points, we go along to the graph. It's going to be not the best line, but you get the idea. And again, and we work out, so going from the graph downwards, we get to 1400, and here we get to 1100. So we do 1400, take away 1100, this is 300. So that's our answer for that one. 300 hours, that is. Okay, estimate the number of type A batteries that had a battery life of more than 1600 hours. Well, 1600's here, so we just need to see how many frequencies are above the graph. And you can see there that it's 4. So 4 batteries. Right, the box plot shows information about the battery life of type B. On average, which type had a greater battery life? So we need to look at the median. For type B here, it's 1300. And let's go back up to the graph. So the median is going to be the 40th value. And let's go along to the graph. That looks to be about 1260 hours. So you'd say, on average, type B had better because the median for B is 1300 hours, while the median for A is 1260 hours. So I hope that makes sense there. Right, a linear sequence starts A plus 2B, A plus 6B, A plus 10B, and you can see the pattern. Each time we're just adding 4B. Right, the second term has value 8, and the fifth term has value 44. So let's have a look. Well, the second term is this one here, A plus 6B, and we're told it's equal to 8. Right, if we carry on this sequence, we get A plus 14B, A plus 18B, and so on here. So, this is the fifth term, and we're told that A plus 18B equals 44. Now, you should recognize this as a pair of simultaneous equations, and we can simply take away the first one from the second one. We'll be left with 12B equals 36. Tells us that B equals 3. Right, now that we know that B equals 3, what can we do? Well, we substitute it back into the first one, and we get A plus 6 times 3 equals 8, and A plus 18 equals 8, and so A equals minus 10. Okay, great, so I've drawn on the lines that pass through the centre of enlargement at 4,1, and this is what we have. So we know that it's been enlarged by scale factor minus 2. So what we do is we look at how many points it takes to get from A to the centre, and that's 1, 2, 3, 4. We're going to multiply that by negative 2, go 8 to the left. 1, 2, 3. this is our new point A. Again, we do a similar thing to get to B. So we go down 2 and to the right 2. So instead we're going to go up 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, and along 4, 1, 2, 3. This is our new point B. And finally, C, we go down 2 and to the right 3. So we're going to go up 4 and along 6. Now all we have to do is carefully join up the lines. So this is what we're left with. We have our new triangle and it's enlarged in the correct way. Okay, question 22. Here we're asked which of these represents the shaded region, and if you know your Venn diagrams well, you'll be able to see that everything in A is shaded and everything that's not in B is also shaded. So the correct answer is A, union B. Okay, question 23. The shopkeeper compares the income sales for a laptop in March and April. Now it says the price is a fifth more than March, but the numbers sold were a quarter less than March. So hopefully you can see that if we set the original price for April, then we now have 6/5 of the price. And the number sold a quarter less than March, well, that means we sold 3/4. So all we have to do is multiply, and this gives us 18 over 20. And we can simplify this to 0.9. So this means the sales decreased by 10%. Because if the sales in March were 1, they've now dropped to 0.9, and you just take them away. Is that a to the n divided by a to the n equals a to the n minus n? And another one is a to the n all to the power of n equals a to the n. Let's look at this. We have 2 to the 14 divided by 2 to the 9 all squared, which is 2 to the 18. Next, this is 2 to the 14 minus 18, which equals 2 to the minus 4. But we know that 2 to the minus 4 is 1 over 2 to the 4. And this equals 1 over 16. At 25 to the 3 over 2. So what does this equal? Well, it equals the square root of 25 cubed, which equals 5 cubed, which equals 125. Here is the sketch of the graph of y equals cosine x with values of x from 0 to 360. Part A, cos of x equals cos of 60. Work out the value of x when it's bigger than 90 and less than greater than 60. So this is 60 degrees here. Go up to the graph. And because of the symmetry of cosine, we can see that this is the same as this value, which is at 300 degrees. So that's our answer there, 300. Cosine of x equals minus cosine of 60. So that's minus this answer, which is going to be sort of down here somewhere. And we're looking for when it's bigger than 180 and less than 360. So all we do is go down, we go along the graph until we reach where that value is. We can see again by the symmetry it's going to be 270 take away 30, which was 240 degrees. Okay, question 26. We're told that B equals 2/3 of C. So this tells us that the ratio of B to C equals 2 to 3. Okay, we're also told that 5A equals 4c. So this tells us that the ratio a to c equals 4 to 5. Because a divided by c is 4 divided by 5. So now we have that a to c is 4 to 5, and b to c equals 2 to 3. The common piece of these is c, so we need to get them the same. The easiest way to do that is to make this 5 into a 15 by timesing everything by 3, and timesing this side by 5. So we now get a to c equals 12 15, b to c equals 10 15. So we have the ratio a to b to c equals 12 to 10 to 15. And that is the simplest form. Okay, Joe wants to work out the solutions of x squared plus 3x minus 5. The solutions cannot be worked out because x squared plus 3x minus 5 does not factorize to x plus a, x plus b, where a and b are integers. Okay, is Joe correct? Well, no, because there are other ways of solving quadratic equations, including the quadratic formula, completing the square, etc. So the quadratic formula could be used. Yeah, so even if a quadratic equation can't be factorized, doesn't mean it's not solvable. Right, without expanding any brackets, show how to work out the exact solutions of this. So let's divide both sides by 9. We get x plus 3 squared equals 4 over 9. Take square root of both sides, we get x plus 3 equals plus or minus square root of 4 over 9, which equals plus or minus 2/3. Yeah. And so if x plus 3 is plus or minus 2/3, then x equals minus 3 plus or minus 2/3. X equals minus 7 over 3, and x equals minus 11 over 3. That's just using the plus or minus there. Right, third question. Simplify this. So the square root of 80 equals square root of 16 times 5, which equals 4 root 5. And this 2 and 2 ninths equals the square root of 20 over 9. That is going to be square root of 20 over 3. And is there any? Just 2 root 5 over 3. Okay, now all we have to do is add them. So we have 4 root 5 plus 2 root 5 over 3, which equals 14 root 5 over 3. Okay, so all we've done is made the 4 root 5 into a 12 root 5 over 3. Then add. Okay, here are sketches of two graphs. The graph of y equals x squared minus 1 is translated 3 units to the left to give graph A. The equation of the graph A can be written in the form x squared plus b equals c. Work out b and c. Right, so if we have y equals x squared minus 1, so to translate negative 3, change it to y equals x plus 3 squared minus 1, and we can expand this. So it's x squared plus 6x plus 9, we still got that minus 1, so this is x squared plus 6x plus 8. So our b is 6, and our c is 8. Okay, great. 29a. 29b. The graph of y equals x squared minus 1 is reflected in the x-axis to give graph P. Work out the equation of graph P. Well, if we come back to this, and we reflect in the x-axis, that means it's going to be something like that. And you should know that if quadratics are positive, they make this sort of smiley face, and if they're negative, they make this sad face. So all we've got to do is take the negative of the whole equation, like so, and this equals 1 minus x squared. So that's our equation of graph P. Okay, finally, question 30. Hopefully you've seen my video where we work out these trig values. So we have this triangle here where we've got this is 1, this is 2, this is root 3, this is 60, this is 30. And from this we can read off everything we need. So sine of 30 degrees equals opposite over hypotenuse, equals a half. Cos of 30 equals adjacent over hypotenuse, which is root 3 over 2. And finally, tan of 60 equals opposite over adjacent, which is root 3 over 1, which is root 3. Now all we have to do is plug in our values that we just obtained. So cos of 30 degrees times tan of 60 plus sine 30. So let's input those values now. Well, cos of 30 is root 3 over 2 times root 3 plus a half. So we're going to get 3 over 2 plus a half, which equals 4 over 2, which equals 2. And that is indeed an integer. Okay, great. I hope that was okay, and let me know if you've got any questions.